BBC Audio presents Henry Fielding, a BBC radio drama collection. Full cast dramatisations of Tom Jones, Joseph Andrews, Jonathan Wilde and the female husband. Henry Fielding was an English novelist and dramatist known for his humorous writing and satire. Writing in the mid-18th century, he is now seen as one of the founders of the traditional English novel. This BBC collection brings together full-cast radio reimaginings of four of his works. The first piece in this collection is the classic comic novel Tom Jones, Fielding's best-known work. First published in 1749, it was among the earliest English works to be classified as a novel. This three-part BBC adaptation was first broadcast in 2007.
Tom Jones by Henry Fielding, dramatised by Stephen Wyatt. Part 1.
This is the history of Tom Jones, a foundling. So it seems only right and proper to start by describing how he was found. In that part of the western division of this kingdom, which is commonly called Somersetshire, lived a gentleman and widower called Allworthy. But he'd been absent a full quarter of a year in London on some very particular business, although sadly I can't tell you what it was.
Bridget!
Brother!
He was greeted by his sister, Bridget, who, for all her admirable qualities, remained unmarried. They had a brief supper, and then Squire Allworthy retired, much fatigued, to his bedroom. As always, he first of all knelt in prayer.
Which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom.
But
come,
as he did so, he became aware of a strange noise.
Oh, no, it cannot be. It cannot be.
But it was. There, lying in his bed, was an infant wrapped up in some coarse linen. He rang for help. An elderly servant woman came running. But the sight of Squire Allworthy wearing nothing but his nightshirt was too much for her. In the end, his sister Bridget came to see what the matter was.
What are you going to do, brother? If the story comes out, there'll be a great deal of tittle-tattle. They'll gossip behind your back and say you are the father. Best to put the baby on the parish.
Look, he's gripping my finger in his tiny hand. He's imploring my assistance.
Is he?
Oh, yes.
Well, at least try and find out who the mother is.
So, you do not deny you are the mother of this child?
No, sir.
Oh, Jenny Jones, you are an intelligent girl. You know that it is in my power to punish you very rigorously for what you've done.
Yes, sir.
Now, as for the child, let no thoughts concerning it molest you. I will provide for it in a better manner than you can ever hope. I intend to adopt him.
Oh, thank you.
So, all that remains is for you to tell me who the father is.
Please don't ask.
Hmm?
I give my word. But thank you for the care you offer to my son. Hmm. With your permission, I'll be gone from here soon. The village bitches are not going to gnaw at my flesh.
The next that was heard of Jenny was that she'd gone off with a recruiting officer. Still, the village found out the father anyway. It was, they believed, one Partridge, an inoffensive married man who worked as both schoolmaster and barber. He'd been giving Jenny Jones private coaching, and everyone knew what that meant. Or thought they did.
So, are you the father of this child?
No, your worship. I swear before God. Well,
this denial will look ill for you, Partridge, in the face of the testimony against you. You realise I cannot continue to pay for you to teach the village children.
That's as good as asking me to leave.
Well, I'm sorry. For both you and your wife.
Oh. She won't come with me.
Hmm?
Praise the Lord.
So the putative parents of the foundling left the village, and Squire Allworthy made the boy his own. He christened him Tom Jones. Well, his mother was a Jones, and the name had a fine, manly English ring. Then suddenly, Miss Bridget Allworthy found herself a husband, one Captain Blifil. Cynics may suggest that Miss Bridget's fortune was an inducement to the handsome captain to propose to a woman of inestimable virtue, but modest looks and years beyond his own. But if the captain looked to a wealthy future, he had an unpleasant surprise. Because he died first. He was not much lamented by his long-suffering wife, who consoled herself with frequent trips to town, but at least she gave him a very handsome tombstone. Maybe because he had given her a son. So Squire Allworthy acquired a nephew not much younger than his adopted son. And here ends the prologue. Now, in this narrative, we do not sit around. If nothing important happens, then we swiftly move on. And so a period of some 18 years has elapsed, and the story of Tom Jones begins.
There they are.
A whole covey of them.
Time to spring them, Master Tom.
Now, be warned, for want of a better, Tom Jones is our hero, but don't expect him to be a model of virtue. He has his faults, and one of his delights is to sneak off secretly and go shooting with Black George, Squire Allworthy's gamekeeper. A poacher turned gamekeeper, who on occasion could always be persuaded to turn poacher again.
There! One down!
Yes, but look.
What of it?
That's Squire Weston's land is fallen on.
It's only a few yards.
You know, the master says never to trespass there.
It's but a few yards. What's the harm?
I could lose my job.
Nobody'll see us. And look. There's another. Come on. What is there to fear?
Damn me, it's too good to waste. Let's go.
That's Squire Weston. He must have heard the shots. George. George?
But when Tom looks round, the more experienced George has disappeared into the thickest part of the furze brake.
Damn you, you thieving, poaching rogues! I'll have your giblets for garters! Well, well, Master Jones. Did you hear those shots just now?
I may have done.
Pox on it! What's that you've got there?
Where, sir?
Don't take me for a half-wit. That's a dead partridge, two dead partridges, in fact, on my land. Damn me, boy, Mr. Allworthy shall hear of this.
Come, Tom, the truth.
The birds originally broke cover on your manor,
sir. That's no excuse for your trespass. And who was with you at the time?
Nobody, sir.
Squire Weston heard two guns. And I know you sometimes hunt with Black George. He denies it all, of course.
I was alone, sir. I truly was.
Tom, I detest falsehood. Maybe the Reverend Mr. Thwackum will change your mind.
Sir, Mr. Thwackum won't change anything. He still yearns for the times when he could beat me within an inch of my life.
Oh, Tom. Still the same wild boy.
I don't mean to upset you.
I know. But you do.
Jones has persisted in an untruth, Mr. Allworthy. He is clearly guilty as charged and should be punished for his sins, preferably corporally.
Or maybe he has lied, but he only did it from a mistaken point of honour, Mr. Thwackum.
Honour? Mere stubbornness and obstinacy. If only you let me beat the truth out of him.
Mr. Thwackum, your meditations are always full of birch because you believe mankind is irretrievably evil.
Without redemption, by God's grace.
What a pity that you have never properly listened to what I have to say.
I have heard more of your ideas than human blood can stand, Mr. Squire.
You always drag religion into it, whereas I believe that human nature is the perfection of all virtue and that vice is a deviation from our nature in the same manner as deformity of body is.
Mankind is naturally evil.
Mankind is naturally good. Oh.
Although this argument rages over profound issues about the very nature of human existence, you would probably prefer to learn that Mr. Allworthy maintains two tutors for Tom and young Blifil. Mr. Square is a philosopher who has no time for organised religion. Mr. Thwackum is a divine with no time for innate human virtue. Mr. Allworthy fondly believes the two lads will therefore receive a balanced education. But sometimes that belief is sorely tested.
No, let us take honour. If by honour we mean the true natural beauty of virtue, then that exists independently of any religion whatsoever.
Oh, yes, so any heretic or infidel may think what they will.
I am talking, sir.
And so am I.
And I am going to bed.
And there the matter might have rested, were it not for a character you have yet to meet, Master Blifil. His
mother is... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.